How would you make a fantasy setting in World War One? Would you make nations of a singular race correspond to the historical nations? British elves, orc Germans.
Oh, that's going to upset a few people.
Make it be a human v human affair with supernatural elements. Vanilla World War One, but the bodies come back to life if not buried, and infantry squads running into isolated villages of fantasy creatures hidden deep in an unexplored forest. Modern nation states with mixed races. Fantasy Britain being a land of multiple fantasy races that identify as British rather than their race. Or something else.
I don't know, I love this concept, but again, I fall for anything. Like give me that World War One stuff, right?
Yeah.
And if you want to add a bit of elements of fantasy, I'm not going to say no.
I'm not opposed to it.
I love me a bit of fan fiction, so, you know, I'm pretty cool.
There would be heavy steampunk elements, since steampunk is basically just World War One anyway.
No. No, it's not, but I can see what they're trying to say. I see what they're trying to say.
England is several races. You're going to have lots of dwarves, especially later in the war, miners from the Midlands. I don't know about the South, different races, also misses with some of the points of World War One. The aristocracy for all sides in the same race, and related. High elves? I don't quite know, but World War One was a fight between Queen Victoria's grandsons.
Yeah, that could work actually quite well with the elf element. Yeah. Yeah, I like that.
And the setting would reflect that. You're basically going to see a high elf lieutenant leading a platoon of dwarves in a raid against his high elf second cousin, who leads a company of wood elves.
Honestly, not that far off from reality, if I be honest with you.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things I love about World War One is it's the first time you see people becoming officers that aren't born into it.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe, like, you know, later down the road, if you do want to use dwarves or humans or whatever, like, you know, they eventually take over that role.
Yeah.
You know, I can see that. I like that. That's pretty cool. Cool concept.
The real question is, what kind of fucked up magical horror should be used to be a metaphor for industrialized warfare? One of the favourites I've used is the gas men. Essentially, they're the flayed skins of humans filled with mustard gas. All the orifices stitched shut, and the arms and legs tied off, and affixed to iron spikes, which the gas man throws around to move slash clumsily stab people. Their main advantage is that they can constantly leak gas from their bodies on command, and can infiltrate and smoke out enemy trenches or fortifications, or explode to the seam. Groups of gas men can walk through miles of forest to reach a target, or are dropped from zeppelins right into a major city, where they skitter towards barracks and defence emplacements.
Honestly, I like that idea.
I like that idea.
They're hyper edgy. However, it does embody that idea of World War One. For me, one of the most gruesome elements is like the zombie land aspect of, and like, you know, how long the bodies are going to lie there. And it, you know,
just
it,
that
it,
whole it, no man's land.
Yeah,
that gives me the
heebie-jeebies. And for me,
like the craters,
you know,
of the dead bodies, and everything stuck in.
And like, God knows what them craters are filled with.
I know.
For me, normally I'd be like, oh, that sounds a bit edgy. That's, you know,
but I get it.
But with World War One, it was edgy.
It was edgy, and it was brutal.
And it's possibly the worst. It is the worst by far, I think.
It was the worst by far. People would say World War II, but
no,
World War One.
World War II's got elements in it.
Yeah.
It's got some things that are like, oh, that's really nasty and that's really nasty.
Yeah.
But World War One across the entire board
was just horrific.
Yeah. And I think that the whole idea of these tortured souls being turned into weapons, I think, embody that quite nicely.
Yeah. Why make individual nations individual species? They seem overly reductionistic, especially for the Eastern Front of World War One. Vast empires vying for control over territory. Huge multi-ethnic forces who didn't speak the same language were common on the Eastern Fronts. Warfare was extremely mobile and surprisingly modern despite the turn of the century gear. I don't have any fantasy-related World War One images. Have a fan myself. Also, the Nazis, if we're going to do fantasy World War II, should be a humanity-first faction with honorary dwarves. Fuck gnomes.
I like that idea. Mm. Now, but the real question is, what would the French Foreign Legion mostly be made up of? Now, if you guys aren't familiar with the French Foreign Legion, it still is in existence today, although it's limited. Essentially, what the idea was is, you come, you fight for the French Empire, and if you serve your time, you gain French citizenship.
Mm-hmm.
That's how France today has such a huge
population.
Migrant population of you lots of different people from all over the world.
Yeah.
It's possibly the most diverse in Europe, I would say.
In France, there is quite a big like African population.
Yeah, there is. But there's again, that's because they're most of France. And also because if you served in their Foreign Legion, you got in. And I think your wife may have got in. But I don't think they recruited against that. They were like, no, we don't want married people. We just want...
We just need numbers.
you're getting fucked in.
Yeah.
I really do love that idea. And I would really like to see what aspects would the French Foreign Legion have with that, you know?
Setting idea. Trench world. Welcome to the Trench Lines. This is a dimension formed where the plane of war, plane of despair, and plane of earth border each other. The Trench Lines are made up of a never-ending labyrinth of World War I style trenches, populated by a myriad of elements, demons, and lost souls all fighting for supremacy. Why would anyone want to go near that hellhole? Is usually the first question asked by anyone planning an excursion through the different planes. It just so happens to be one of the fastest ways to get around. You have easy access from the elemental planes to the negative planes. From the plane of despair, you can easily reach the plane of torment, or the plane of anger. Several other planes intersect it as well, such as the plane of water and the plane of death. For crusaders and adventuring types, there is a shortcut to the fifth circle of hell. If you're plane walking in a hurry on a budget, the trench lines are the way to go.
I really like that idea. I like that idea. That's actually a really cool concept. I'm really tempted to steal this at some stage. I really like this idea and I really want to steal it, so we'll just see what happens, will we?
England, goblins, American, orcs, Germans, high elves, French, gremlins, Ottomans, dwarfs, Russians, ogres, and Austrians, dry.
Nah, I'm not gonna have no Ottomans as dwarves. Mm. There's no way. I don't like that. Doesn't sit well with me. I like my dwarves, and as far as I'm concerned, the Ottomans were entirely useless. Okay, who was really useless during World War
I? I think the dwarves and goblins should be switched because tell me dwarves are I know they're
first. Come on, England. the Northern English types.
Yeah, I know they're meant to be from like Scandinavian countries, but like tell me they're not like British.
I do get that feel from them. Okay, so for me personally, England, out of them ones, I'm going to lean on more humans and dwarves. America, I have no idea. America,
I get because the Germans because, as high elves.
Yeah, I get what they're trying to say, but I know that's going to upset a lot of people.
I know, but I get it.
I'm having the Ottomans as gremlins. I don't care. I really don't like the Ottomans were useless. So were the Australians, and so were the Russians. Them three may as well not have even been there. Like, you know, they were absolutely shit. The only decent armies in World War One was like, okay, I'm going to say it right now. The Germans were the best. They may have lost, but I definitely think they put out the heaviest punches by far.
Yeah.
I don't even think it's a competition. They managed to kill way more British, French, and American, Russian, everyone else every single month, and the only time they lost more than them was the very last month, so you know, I think that speaks a lot for them. After them, I would argue the English were the French, I do think, fought extremely well. However, they just got their heads kicked in, and I think it led their way for them to be steamrolled again in World War II, just because I think they just got hit too hard. Like they got battered so bad. It destroyed the morale of a nation.
Yeah.
Would that be a fair way to say it? Sorry, guys, I'm getting sidetracked.
What if you were on the border of Germany?
Oh, yeah, and it's all your land being destroyed, you know, and they're still trying to repair the countryside to this day.
I know.
What would you guys say out of this list? How would you put it down? You know, it's an interesting concept, you know. Although, personally for me, I'd rather the Australians be dry, like down under, you know what I mean? I kind of, you know, kind of funny.
Yeah, get it. Okay. We get it. Hey guys, do you like models in your tabletop role-playing games? Because we do too. Do you like having big bitty waifus on your table? Because we do too. We got human biddies, we got lizard biddies, we got orc biddies, oni biddies, cat bussies. We've got everything you want at neckbeardia.co.uk.
Check the links down below, it helps us out a lot.
Sorry for interrupting the video, let's get on with the story. Post-epic fantasy. The Demon King is dead and the world is changing. Magic becomes more formal and magic item assembly lines appear. The nations begin to form a sort of league slash coalition. Some countries are holding out, but it's pretty apparent that the new order is taking hold. The age of adventurers is coming to an end. As things become more and more civilized, this will, of course, ultimately lead to Magic World War I. But how will your adventurers make their way in a world where they are less and less relevant?
I like that.
That's a good idea.
You know what that is? That's to me like a reimagining of Tolkien's Lord of the Rings almost. Yeah. You know, that whole the world is changing type of, you know, that mentality of the old way is gone. And, you know, with World War One, it was really the clashing of two time periods so heavily smashed together. Really fucking hard. Like, you know, one of my favorite examples is, okay, so French cavalry. They still have breastplates, they've still got horsehair helmets. You know, they look like Napoleon's cavalry. And, like, you know, that was really 100 years ago.
Yeah.
But because they haven't had a major war in Europe
they haven't had a need to change.
Exactly. And it's in the technological advances. What do they call it? The Pax Britannica? The peace that was caused by the British Empire, just because, you know, if the British Empire own everything, you can't. And also, like, you know, that was one of the big causes at the start. I remember I was reading one where they were talking about with the start of World War One, Britain really shouldn't, like, they were saying, oh no, Britain can't get involved. Like, you know, think of the trade that's going on. We're richer than we've ever been before in our lives. Why would we go to war and waste that?
Yeah.
That seems like such a horrible idea. Little did they know, ruining the economy was on the low end of the agenda of what the outcome would be of World War One.
Yeah.
It really makes you think of what these people were thinking, you know, what they were going into.
I would probably not try to straight up copy World War One if I wanted my elves and dwarves and whatever, but rather take some major themes and causes. Old dynastic empires clinging to power, arms races, ethnic nationalism, imperialism, etc. And flesh them out in a fantasy context. Maybe throw in some magic versus technology plot, since World War One is very much the death of the old world, or at least the romantic idea of the old world. And besides, there needs to be some rhyme and reason to the wizards anyway, to explain why they don't change the context so much. It's no longer World War I-esque.
That's true. That is true. I do like that idea of maybe just more focusing on the overarching themes of World War One. And the thing is, well, World War One, there's so many different angles to look at this. You know, it is because you can do this with any world war. You can look at it in any different light and you can get a different result, you know?
Elves. Basically Switzerland. They are neutral and too up their asses to care about anything beyond themselves. All magic protections on their lands make it impossible to invade with an army. Dwarfs. They're the Panzer Elite! But seriously, think about better races to make war machines and build trenches and fortifications.
He does have a solid point there.
They've been doing this for centuries against goblinoids. Halflings. Spain style. Don't give a fuck about it until bombs start dropping in their heads. Probably will try to please whatever side's winning and spy for them, selling info to whoever offers for more protection.
I can see that with halflings.
Half-orcs. Australians. Just no other... Humans. Are you kidding me? Dragonborn. Other group is too full of shit to take their war seriously until someone bombs their territory with mustard gas. But they will probably get back the lost time before the end and become a force to reckon with. Tiefling. Concentration camps and sterilization. Seriously, no one of the other races liked them. This war would be the perfect excuse to kill all of them and make it sound noble.
Yeah, actually, could you see that with the Ottomans?
You know,
maybe
they're not wrong.
Maybe with the Ottomans, with that genocide that they had.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, actually, now that I think about it, World War One is a good
You heard it here first. James wants to commit genocide against Tieflings.
What is said here does not represent the ideas and views of Nick Beardia. Do not take anything out of context. I'm not getting into any of this bullshit. All right, this is not World War Two. This is World War One. It's very different. Just keep going.
Gnomes. No one cares. Goliaths. Those dudes would act as mercenaries and shock troopers to whoever paid the most. Just imagine a big grey dude charging at you with an anti-tank rifle with a curved bayonet, making the entire thing a kind of halberd. Metal.
That is metal. That's pretty brutal, not gonna lie. Like.
Orcs and goblinoids. probably from war bands, taking abandoned equipment left in the fields and forests after combat and arming themselves.
Gorkamorka
style.
Cowabunga.
This would make rules for involved armies to never leave crucial or dangerous equipment on the field. Take that shit with you or sabotage it. Just don't let the orcs have it. Everything else, they're just too irrelevant.
Yeah, I like that. That was a pretty good sum up of the... Yeah. I could see that. Definitely with the high, with the elves, I could see that. Dwarves perfectly sum that up. Goliaths, that seems pretty metal to me. And tieflings, that doesn't seem too far to the realm of reality. Let's be serious, guys. So how would you guys approach World War One in a fantasy setting? You know, the biggest problem is magic when it comes to any setting. Like, you know, that's why civilizations don't really advance to, like, our level of technology. Because why would you, whenever you've got magic to do the job? I feel like that's the biggest problem when it came to the Romans, for example. The Romans could do an awful lot of stuff, but I think they could have got a lot further if they just didn't use slaves. Mm-hmm. I think slaves retard the progress of technology, because once you stop using slaves, then suddenly you have to come up with new ideas of how to do things, which are actually a lot more effective. Yeah. But like, that's a side point, you know. How would you guys approach this? I think there's a lot of different angles you could attack this from, and I am very interested in it. I do love World War One, and, like, you know, I do love a bit of fan fiction, you know.
Yeah, I'm interested in what you guys think about this.
Yeah, how would you guys...
how you would go about it.
And what
races would you put where, or would you merge a lot of races and stuff?
You know, there was one I was actually thinking about. I was thinking about making a range... Now, this was actually an idea I had a while back, to make, like, a World War One style fighter rifleman subclass. Right, so it's going to be a fighter, right? But you're going to give him mold earth and shit so he can build trenches and all that. Mm-hmm. We're going to need to give him some form of, like, very basic rifle. Like, you know, okay, we'll just reskin a bow or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, I think there's a few things you could do. Maybe set traps with barbed wire, stuff like that. I am really interested in making the subclass at some stage. But we'll just get there with it. Do you guys have anything you've ever done with this sort of stuff? I don't know. I don't know.
Let us know down below.
Yeah, let us know.
While you're here, check the links down below too. Go to the website, check the models and our t-shirts and all the subclasses that we have. Hit subscribe and the notification bell so you get notified every time we post. And we'll see you in the next video. Bye!